All right. Well, good morning. My name is Arthur Hellman, and as the chair of the Planning Committee, I'd like to welcome you to this historic conference on a court transformed. The Ninth Circuit, the Omnibus Judgeship Act of 1978, and the Carter judges. This year marks the 40th anniversary of the Act, and we're taking this opportunity to examine and reflect upon the profound changes that came to the Ninth Circuit as a result of the Act and the Carter appointments. We're greatly honored to have with us today eight distinguished judges of the Ninth Circuit, including four who were appointed by President Carter. On behalf of all of us here, I want to express deep appreciation to these judges, both those on the bench now and those who will be speaking later. They have taken a tremendous amount of time out of their very demanding schedules to participate in these panels. I'll add also that it has been a great personal pleasure to work with all of them. We have a full agenda, so I will leave further introductions at the start of each panel. But I would be remiss if I did not note that putting on an event of this size and complexity requires work and dedication by a great many people. In the interest of brevity, I'm not going to thank them individually at this point, but I urge you to look at the inside back cover of your program where you will find them listed, and I hope we have listed all of them. We really appreciate everything they have done. I do want to mention our four sponsors: the California Academy of Appellate Lawyers, the Appellate Court Section of the Los Angeles County Bar Association, the Political Science Department at Loyola Marymount University, and the Ninth Judicial Circuit Historical Society. We're grateful to all of them also. Two logistical things. If you're here for CLE and did not sign the specific CLE sheet at the front door, do so. And finally, I will ask you to please mute your cell phones or other electronic devices so that we hear the panel interrupted. Now, I will turn over the program to an outstanding scholar of the federal courts, Professor Emeritus Thomas D. Rowe, Jr. of the Duke University Law School, who will be moderating the first panel. Tom, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Arthur, and welcome to this, what we hope will be very interesting and worthwhile conference. Two events, one in 1977 and one in 1978, provide the framework for the subject of this first panel, getting them there. And the first was that in February 1977, within a month after President Carter took office, he issued an executive order establishing United States Circuit Judge Nominating Commissions, and their purpose was to make recommendations to the President for people who should be nominated to fill vacancies on the federal courts of appeals. The commission operated through panels, and there were two for the Ninth Circuit, one for the North and one for the South, and we'll be hearing more about the commission from Judge Nelson. The second event, of course, was the enactment of the Omnibus Judgeship Act of 1978. The act had a tortuous history. Judge Wallace may have a bit more to say about this bill's evolution. For now, I'll just tell you that the first version of the bill was introduced at the very beginning of the 95th Congress in January 1977, and it was not signed into law until after the 95th Congress had adjourned in October 1978. The bill created 10 new judgeships for the Ninth Circuit, taking its authorized strength from 13 to 23. That was one of its two key features. The other relevant to the Ninth Circuit, and the other is that it authorized any court of appeals with more than 15 active judges to perform its en banc function by fewer than all active judges. This limited en banc panel will be the subject of the third panel, which will be after lunch. And in this panel, we will be looking at the nomination and confirmation procedure for the judges appointed under the Act and other judges appointed by President Carter, of whom, for the Ninth Circuit, there were 15 in all, 10 to fill the new judgeships and 5 to fill vacancies. I will give you just the very quick introduction to our panelists. You will find more about them in your programs. And then I'll just give quick introductions of all 5 of them as we start, and then turn it over to each of them in turn. And leading off on my far right is Judge Dorothy Nelson. She had been dean of the University of Southern California School of Law. She was appointed in 1979 and took senior status in 1995. Next, we have Judge Mary Schroeder. She had been on the Arizona Court of Appeals. She was also appointed in 1979, and she served as chief judge from 2000 to 2007, and she took senior status in 2011. And on my immediate right is Judge William Canby, who had been on the Arizona State Law Faculty, and he took senior status in 1996. And immediately to my left is Judge Stephen Reinhart, who is the only Carter appellate judge appointee not to have departed or taken senior status. And
the latter, right?
And then on my extreme left, where he may not be accustomed to finding himself, Judge Clifford Wallace, who had been district judge for the Southern District of California and was appointed in 1972. He served as chief judge and has been on senior status since 1996. With that, I will turn it over to Judge Nelson.
Thank you, Professor Rao. I understand we have 2 externs down here that are charged with keeping us on time, so I'm not going to waste any time. I do want to thank Arthur Hellman for organizing this. Well, it's titled Getting There. How did we get there? It all started for me with Roscoe Pound, the former dean of the Harvard Law School, who was Dean Emeritus at UCLA Law School, where I attended, and I see some of my former students in this audience. Roscoe Pound said, well, he wrote this famous article that I put in the first chapter of my casebook, The Causes of Popular Dissatisfaction with the Administration of Justice. One cause was the way judges were selected. And I had him for 7 courses, and I heard about merit selection, merit selection, merit selection. He, in 1913, founded the American Judicature Society, and when I graduated, he gave memberships in that society, which was dedicated in part to promoting merit selection of judges. He gave us memberships. Well, when President Carter was elected, I happened to be chairman of that society, and I'm a political independent, so I'm not a Democrat, not a Republican, but because I was the only woman dean of a major law school, every president, Republican and Democrat, appointed me to commissions, and I got to know a lot of people in Washington. Well, much to my surprise, Attorney General Griffin Bell called me up and said, okay, Dorothy, I want you to bring your team back to Washington, and we're going to set up merit selection for appellate court judges. So I took 4 members of the society. We went back to former Attorney General Mitchell's justice chambers, and his wife, who had a flair for decoration, had decorated his dining room and had not been changed, and red flock wallpaper, red velvet tulips, a red chandelier. It was sort of like a bordello, but we were there, and we set up the panels that are around the country. And President Carter came in and said, I want you to charge those panels with seeking out women and minorities. And the panels were set up, and a couple of months later, the panel came to visit me at USC Law School. I said, we want to submit your name. And I said, oh, I've been dean 13 years. I want to go back and be just a regular person and have a life. Well, I went home, and my husband, who died as a Superior Court judge, was then presiding judge of the LA Municipal Court. He said, you've been criticizing judges all your academic life. Why don't you see what it's like to really be one? Well, there were 5 openings at the time, and the panel nominated 4 from the South, 1 from the North. Senator Hayakawa, whom I did not know, nor did I know Senator Cranston from the South, looked down and said, aha, academic, I'm going to hold up her blue slip, which he did. Well, a few months later, Senator Kennedy called me and said, Jean, you got the votes. Senator Hayakawa will not turn in his blue slip, but because your commissions said, we don't have to wait, come back for your hearing. Well, I was sitting in the Justice Department, and a messenger came and said to me, Senator Hayakawa wants to see you before the hearing. Senator Cranston has said to me, he will not say a word about you. Don't worry about it. I will introduce you properly. Well, my heart beating, I walked down the hall and thought, my mother taught English, and she used Senator Hayakawa's book on the meaning of words, on semantics, in all of her classes. So I walk in and say, Senator Hayakawa, I'm so happy to meet you. My mother has used your book in all of her classes for over a decade. Oh, he said, she has. Sit down, young lady, let's talk. Well, we got in for my commission hearing, and Senator Cranston had just sort of said, don't worry. But Senator Hyrule got up and read every word of my 3-page resume. Senator Cranston went like that, and that's how I got on the bench. And you just never count on what's going to happen. Well, I'd like to say, and I see the daughter of one of my most favorite people on the bench. We were all appointed at the same time. And Chief Justice Burr had us all up to his chambers, just the women, not the men, and had us in for tea and made us, no matter what you think about his opinions, he made us feel very welcome in the court. So I felt very lucky. Number one, that I knew Roscoe Pound. Number two, that I knew Griffin Bell. Number three, that President Carter made good on his promise that he would bring about merit selection. Oddly enough, when he was no longer president, the next president did away with merit selection, but there were 13 panels, 7 of them continued to keep their merit selection committees. And to this day, it depends on what state you're in, there are some merit selection committees. But that answers the question about getting them there.
Thank you very much, Judge Nelson. And next we will hear from Judge Mary Schroeder.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here. I apologize for being a little late. I've been on the road for 7 days, and I couldn't get everything right back into my little teeny-weeny suitcase this morning. But Is that the same? Dorothy's mother must have been remarkable. I'm really sorry I didn't know. Is that the same mother whose picture is in Maui surfing?
My mother was the first white surfer. she actually, you're using your time, trained for the Olympics in Hawaii, a freestyle swimmer, and she made the semifinals and lived in Maui. She had been at Berkeley and taught school. But there is a picture of my mother in Lahaina, in the Pioneer Inn, in the bar.
Yes.
My mother with her old-fashioned swimsuit and her 10-foot mahogany board. Thank you, Judge
Schroeder. Well, I think the point that I was trying to make with that, which is that we were all, I think the Carter judges were all very strong people. They came from strong stock. And this is just one illustration of it, I think. My recollection, and Tom Rowe and Art Hellman may correct me on this, but my recollection is that the history of the Judgeship Act of 1978 actually goes back to the 60s, and when it was recognized that there needed to be new judges, and it got all balled up with the problems in the Fifth Circuit, where the senators refused to add any judges to the Sixth Circuit because they didn't like the decisions on they didn't like the Fifth Circuit decisions on integration, and they wanted to break it up. And going back to the 60s, when Chief Judge of the Ninth Circuit was Richard Chambers and then succeeded by Jim Browning, absolutely stood firm that the Ninth Circuit was not going to be divided and that we needed a lot of judges. And the view of that they took of the Fifth Circuit was, well, you're going to be too big if we add any judges, so we have to break you up. And the Ninth Circuit said, that's not true. We are going to prove that we can function as a large circuit, but we need our judges. And this went on for a number of years. My understanding was always that the fix was kind of in, that there would be a judgeship bill. Wasn't quite sure who would get what, but that it would be after the election of 1976, because I don't think you can really pass a big judgeship bill if you know who's going to make all the appointments. I always understood that the deal was kind of made that that there would be a bill, nobody knew who was going to make the appointments, and it turned out to be Jimmy Carter. And as Dorothy has said, he vowed during the campaign that he was going to bring diversity to the bench. And you really have to understand that up until that time there was no diversity, except in the Ninth Circuit there was one woman. The Ninth Circuit has always been the most diverse court, I think. And we had one woman, Shirley Huffstetler, and one Asian American in Herb Choi. But it was a small court. It was a very conservative court, and it badly needed judges because of the tremendous caseload. Of course, now we think that caseload was minuscule. I think there were like maybe 100 cases per judge, and now we have 700, but that's neither here nor there. Anyway, Carter came in. He was committed to diversity, and he announced that he was going to have merit commissions. And in Arizona, we were very, very used to merit selection because we'd had merit selection of judges since 1974. I was the first merit selection appointee to the Arizona Court of Appeals. And so I was sitting there as the only woman on the Arizona appellate bench, and it was negotiated that there would be another judge from, a new judge added from Arizona. I put my name in. I wasn't sure that I was going to get nominated by the commission because I was very young. It turned out I was not quite as young as Tony Kennedy when he was appointed, but it was close. So, I had an interview with the commission, which was rather memorable. The committee was chaired by a woman who was from, I think, Flagstaff, who was very gracious, and a man who was absolutely dug in that we shouldn't have women who have families. And so he, I recall him saying, turning to me in the midst of the interview, where I thought I was doing really well, talking about judicial administration and efficiency. We rode to this on a judicial administration ticket. And he turned to me and he said, "Have you given thought to how you will ruin your family if you become a judge on the Ninth Circuit?" I had at that time a child, two daughters, one was 6 and one was 2. And I said, "Yes, I have thought about what this appointment would mean if I were to get it. I've discussed it thoroughly with my husband. I have been to see Judge Trask, who was then the Arizona judge on the court, to find out how much travel is involved. I know that there are so many cases. I went through the whole thing. I was thoroughly prepared for this." And the man shut up. But afterwards, I was really quite surprised that the chair, the woman, as I recall, came to my house. She was so mortified by the question and said that after they were having their discussions about who should be nominated, she turned to him, or perhaps even before they interviewed the next person, she turned to him and she said, "How could you ask that question of that woman applicant when the candidate we interviewed just before her had 6 children and was male and you didn't ask a thing?" So the whole gender diversity thing was a little bit touchy in those days, I think is the point that I'm trying to make. I was appointed, or I was nominated, and then my mentor in practice was a wonderful lawyer named John Frank, who was the Zion of the Democratic Party, and he ran a campaign for me, basically. It was like a political campaign to get the nomination after the appointment, because there were 3 of us. The biggest problem that I faced, Justice Department was in charge of trying to shepherd through people. I talked to the Justice Department. They said, "Well, the biggest problem you have is that one of the other people who's nominated is the brother-in-law of the vice president, and we'll just have to work around that." That was Judge Canby, who was Mondale's brother-in-law. They didn't know that in the Justice Department until rather late in the process. I think they were a little bit naive about some of this. But anyway, John orchestrated a kind of a campaign where there were letters going in from, I had been very active in the community, and so we had letters to the senator going in from the labor, from the Equal Rights Amendment was being campaigned for then, the chair of the Equal Rights Amendment Committee, the women lawyers, the NAACP. And I wound up, because I was from a law firm originally that had both Democrats and Republicans, I wound up getting the support of both Senator DeConcini and Senator Goldwater. So my hearing was kind of a love fest by the time we got through all of that. But it was not all easy all the way along the way. I think that while Dorothy knew some folks who were instrumental and very influential, Griffin Bell among others, when I was finally confirmed, I believe one of the columnists in the local paper said that when all is said and done with all of this noise about merit selection and everything else, the best thing to keep in mind is know thy senator.
Thank you very much, Judge Soter. And we will next hear from Judge Canby.
Okay, I don't have as much background in the nominating commissions as inception of them as you've already heard about. And I'm more of a consumer of the institution of the merit commissions. But I do have a couple of reflections on them. One is that the merit commissions, one of the touchy things about having merit commissions is that local senators don't much care for that. Before the merit commissions, the senators, we think, just appointed who they wanted, and they didn't have all this mess about going through a commission and everything else. But in fact, what the merit commission can do is not just pick the best candidates, and I think we've had a couple of examples how they do that, but they raise the floor. And the merit commission is protection against somebody who's really unqualified. And in fact, the senators came to realize that that gets them off the hook. There may be somebody they're indebted to or has connections or something that is just clearly unqualified. Now they can say, that person didn't get through the merit commission. It wasn't me. You know, I would have done what I could for this, my good friend and your good friend. So it gave a certain amount of protection for raising, for excluding. So it's the important thing about the commissions is not just who they got appointed, it's who they got not to be appointed. And I think that was a very useful thing for the commissions. Now, I can say that because I have more experience maybe with nominating commissions than maybe anybody here. I was a two-time loser. In 1978, one of the existing vacancies came up, and I applied along with others. And I did make a short list, and Tom Tang got the nomination. This was not one of the expansion judges. This was the pre-1978 expansion. And the second time around in 1979, I once again applied, and Judge Schroeder got the nomination. And, you know, I didn't find this very depressing. And the reason was that I enjoyed the other best legal job in the world, and that is teaching constitutional law in an American law school. That's not an unpleasant thing to be doing. It's a wonderful thing to be doing. A year later, Ozell Trask took senior status, and that kind of unexpectedly, I mean, it was going to happen sometime, opened up another Arizona slot. And it was just within a year after the last merit commission round. So either the White House or the Justice Department told Senator DeConcini, our Arizona Democratic senator at the time, that if he wanted to not wait for another merit commission round, he could appoint somebody who was on the short list last time. And the short list last time only had three people on it. So Senator DeConcini, he called me one afternoon when I was at the law school and said, you're it. I never had any doubt who really made the decision among the people that got through the merit commission. And to my mind, that was Senator DeConcini. I never doubted that he was my appointing authority. The other thing, or to back up for a second, that commissions can do, I think, better than the old system, that you've already heard that in putting the commissions together, one of President Carter's desires, and that of several others, was that there be a much more mixed, inclusive appointment process, that minorities and women would be given really a good shot at nomination. A commission is a little better to able to effectuate that than the old system was, because under the old system, every appointment was just a one-shot thing. There's only one opening. There's only one candidate. I mean, there are many candidates maybe coming to the senator, but it's a one-time thing. And it's harder to say we want a proper balance when you're just making one appointment. a merit commission winds up interviewing several candidates for several different judgeships, and they get a much better sense of what the mix is. You know, what kind of candidates are we sending forward? And I think they can be afford to be much more sensitive to a good balance of approved candidates than the individual appointment authority can be. So I guess that's really all the comments I have on the commission. I think they worked well. The only question I remember that was at all tricky in the last commission hearing was a member from Nevada saying, what was my position on the public land dispute? And it was very specific to Nevada. And of course, I had to do what all candidates do and say, well, you know, I would have to see what all the considerations were and would have to read the briefing papers on each side and everything else and then decide. And in other words, I can't commit to a promise in what's probably going to be a specific case. And that was the only, otherwise the questions were very good. Incidentally, one of the questions was, you know, we are interested in getting numbers of women and minorities appointed to the court, and does that give you any kind of a problem? And I said, you know, I can't complain about discrimination in my life. I have anything I ever wanted. That was my answer. But it all worked out in the end, both from my standpoint and from the diversity standpoint. That's all.
Thank you very much, Judge Canby. And the next panelist from whom we will hear is Judge Reinhardt.
Well, although we carded judges thought we were the most meritorious judges because we are the ones who were supposedly appointed on the basis of merit. You know, it depends on what kind of smokescreen you want to look at this through. Who appoints the Merit Selection Committee? Whoever appoints the Merit Selection Committee decides who, in effect, are the nominees going to be. If you leave it up to the bar, which is, I'm sure, the theory of Roscoe Pound and the other bar leaders, you get one kind of judge appointed. If you leave it up to the senator to appoint the Merit Selection Committee, you get a totally different kind of appointee. So, you know, merit selection is in the eye of the beholder, or really more in the eye of the person selecting the Merit Selection Committee. So I've never believed in that, although I do think we had more merit than all the other appointees. Now, just quickly to say, take the appointees from Southern California. One was picked by Senator Cranston, that was Warren Ferguson. One was picked by Jim Corman, the chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee, that was Harry Pragerson. One was picked by, let's see, who was the other? Well, Dorothy got picked because she had merit. they needed a woman, and there weren't too many around. And she was very involved in all of this, and the obvious person to take that position. But I was picked by the mayor, Tom Bradley, and President Carter, actually, probably I'm the only one that he got involved with. There was a primary going on between Ted Kennedy and Jimmy Carter, and California being a liberal state, and I being a liberal person, we were for Ted Kennedy. But Tom Bradley was a strong supporter of Jimmy Carter's and stood by him because Carter did a lot for Los Angeles. So when Carter was out here, he said, Tom, what can I do for you? And Tom said, well, I have a very close friend I'd like to have appointed to the Ninth Circuit. He said, fine. Tom wrote down my name and put it in Jimmy Carter's pocket. And Jimmy Carter went back and said that he wanted me to be on. I think he thinks I was black. Because Tom Bradley was, and the head of our merit selection committee was black. So I would be think certainly Griffin Bell was surprised that I wasn't. But anyway, you know, we had a nice political selection through the merit selection committee, which is what frequently happens, even in today's committees. Donald Trump, if he knows what's being done for him, will have a committee in a state, and they'll say, send us four names. Then the White House counsel calls the committee and says, we want included among those four names Joe Smith. And they figure, well, okay, we can put him in with the others. And then it goes, they get four names go back, and they appoint the man that they, or woman, not likely woman, they appoint the man that they have told the committee they want forwarded. Well, anyway, this is all a wonderful system, but there's no doubt that the appointments are still being made, always have been, and were when we had merit selection committees on a political basis, which is all right. I don't have time in 10 minutes to tell you the story of my horrendous experience in getting confirmed. I particularly don't want to because today's a very sensitive day for the FBI, who everybody assumes is politically neutral or a left-wing organization. You know, if you go back from J. Edgar Hoover to the campaign against Martin Luther King conducted by the FBI, you would find that it is not part of the liberal conspiracy. In fact, I think if you took a poll of the members of the FBI who they voted for in the last election, you would be clearly demonstrated to you that the members of the FBI were not part of the Hillary Clinton gang. I had not a very pleasant experience with the FBI. I had been head of the president of the Los Angeles Police Commission, and we were a reform commission. Our job was to try to solve some of the police problems that we're still trying to solve today. And we brought reforms, including a new shooting policy, and a re-examine of what was PDID, which was known as intelligence. Intelligence in the police department and throughout the country in law enforcement agencies meant that looking for conspirators. Conspirators were people who might be considered to be not pro-police or pro-labor or Reds. We had a most unfortunate political intelligence squad in the LAPD, and we tried to dismantle that, which made them very unhappy. So when I was nominated, there was a considerable opposition from police forces at national and local. And I had a remarkable experience in which witnesses were dug up. There were reports written that I was a relative of the leading gangster from Las Vegas, whom I'd never heard of before, that I had connections with all kinds of organizations I didn't know anything about. These were fostered by law enforcement agencies, and it turned into quite an experience. When I went for my confirmation and met with the staff, I didn't get any help by the Carter White Attorney General's office because they were feuding with the Senate, which was the chairman of the committee was Senator Kennedy, and they were not, the Attorney General and the White House were not very helpful in general. But when I got there, I was told there was a man who was going to come and testify about how I had transferred bundles of cash to the governor, who was then Jerry Brown, in paper bags at a restaurant. And Jerry Brown was the last person in the world who would take cash at a restaurant. But they found witnesses they were going to produce at the Senate hearing. I was then told, look, if you come up, they're going to produce this witness against you. It's the end of the session. And if this becomes controversial, you'll never get through. So I said, well, okay, then, you know, you think I shouldn't come? They said, well, if you don't come, there won't be time for a hearing, and you won't get confirmed. Well, anyway, this is a long story,
yeah.
But it happened that there was someone in the Attorney General's office who gave orders to the FBI to disclose the name of the witness, where he was being held, so that the Senate could investigate this and deal with this confidential witness. Well, that's just a touch of the process I went through. And it was only by some miracle that on a day when Jesse Helms and a few of the pro-law enforcement people were away that somebody got my name on a consent calendar. And nobody knew it when I was being confirmed, because there were only two or three senators there. So anyway, and the way I could tell you how we got the votes of some of the senators, including the lady one of them was sleeping with, that was one of the prime. I had to get votes from three Republicans and three Democrats. Each one had a weakness, and as a result of that, we managed to get me through to the horror of lots of people still today. Although I must say, Cliff Wallace was in charge of getting us all through, and he was, for him, quite nonpartisan, and was a help to all of us. Okay.
Thank you very much, Judge Reinhardt.
Anyway, it was a lovely experience.
And now we will hear from someone who watched the whole process from having been on the bench before it started, Judge Wallace.
Well, Steve, that was very brave of you to talk about this, and he only told part of it. It was one of the things that isn't the nicest that happens. We like to think of justices and the justice system as being pure. It isn't. It's political, and it depends upon a lot of things. And it looked like everything was going against Steve. He was the last of the Carter appointees. Actually, 1 year, but it took 1 year to get him through, and it was just before the gate went down. If we had lost any time at all, he would not have been on the bench. I remember that one of the senior staffers, which was on Steve's side, was getting in touch with me, and he was trying to get me, I guess, to work harder, because he says, he'll be a good judge. He's not as bad as they say. And I thought, and I've told Steve many times that maybe I took that assignment too literally, and I shouldn't have worked quite as hard as I did. But no one really believes that, not even me. Steve is a brilliant lawyer, and he was been a great judge and a good friend. We seem to end up periodically seeing things differently, but both of us have a different projection in our view. But I can tell you this, that Steve is a great friend, and when we let our different views interfere with friendship, that's when we courts disseminate and they no longer can work together. And we've had experiences like that with some of the circuits. Frankly, quite frankly, we haven't here. We can accommodate. But that was interesting. Let me just go back to what I was going to be talking about. We didn't care anything about politics. We wanted judges. And that was the view. And we had known for some time I think Mary is correct. I think the deal was in what they were going to do, because the problem was the ninth and the fifth, and what they were going to do is get something in compromise. Well, the compromise was that you could divide, and or you could stay together, and we'll talk later about the new in-bank process, and we could divide into divisions. But we're going to have the judges, and that was the key part. We were going to get judges. We didn't worry about the other part. We needed the judges to get rid of our backlog. And so Jim Browning, who was then the chief judge, asked me to take on the responsibility of chairing a group, turned to be at a group as a group of one until Otto Scopel was added to it, of doing what we could to get judges through. We weren't picking judges. That was up to another process. But we just wanted the judges. And that was the position that we took out. And John and Jim was very strong on this. And no one could be sure that Jimmy Carter was going to last longer than one term. And he did only last one term. But we had to get all 10 of those. And we had to get it in the first 4 years because we weren't sure that we would have, we'd be able to carry them over into the term of another president. And it turned out that Judge Carter lasted 4 years. But we were, our whole game plan was to get our judges, whomever he ended up selecting, on the position. So there's another part of the process which was interesting, and that was the ones who were going senior. There was five that went senior during these 4 years. So we then weren't getting 10, we were getting 15, and we wanted all 15. If you don't get them during that term, the new president takes a long term to get time to get the gears going, and we not even we got them, they'd be much delayed. So all of us were focusing on the first 4 years, not for 10 judges, but for 15 judges. And then that's what we were trying to push. So this meant we had a tremendous responsibility that we tried to get all 15. Judge Browning's leadership was that this is a political process and we're not involved in it. I happen to be somewhat of a skeptic, like my good friend to my right. these teams, I think the merit selection program did one good thing. It started opening up the process to others than the typical white judge who's been on a senior partner from a law firm or been a judge in a district court for some time. And that was sort of the tube it went through. And the opening up of the peripheral vision to bring in others, I think, was an important process. But they've always been merit in some fashion. And I agree with Steve is that there may be coding or names on it. And we just hope that in the political process, they'll give us the best judges. And that usually works out fairly well. But whatever it was okay. We wanted to keep it nonpartisan as far as we were concerned. And if they're going to be all Democrats, that's fine. And I think of the 10 Carter judges, eight were Democrats. We had one nonpartisan and an Arthur who is a Republican, but he worked for Pat Brown, so he had a special merit selection chip to play in that one. The strange part about it was getting them there, and I won't take the time because you can guess what we were doing. We were just working with people, making phone calls, making trips, trying to do our part to let them know the court was in favor of bringing whomever was selected along. I'm not sure how much good we did, but what I am sure is we got our judges, and that was the good part.
If I could just have 1 second to add something to what Cliff said. Yes, Dorothy was the only non-Democrat other than Arthur. The way Arthur got appointed was my friend Sam Williams, who was chairman of the Merit Selection Committee. Sam and I used to run Tom Bradley's campaigns together. And during the campaigns, Sam had this friend, Arthur, who helped us with the law enforcement issues. And so he was Hispanic, and there were very few Hispanic candidates. And so Sam picked Arthur, and Arthur got nominated. And then the night before Arthur's name was going to the Senate, Sam called Arthur and I heard this story from both Sam and Arthur. Sam called Arthur and said, "Arthur, there's a terrible rumor that you're a Republican." And Arthur said, "Oh, sure, yeah, I'm a Republican." And Sam said, "Holy shit." And that was a way that out of all the Carter nominees, we got one Republican.
Well, he, can I just add to that? Arthur was publicly proclaimed to be a Hispanic and representative of all of the Hispanic folks. And it turned out that his ancestors came over with the conquistadors, I think it was. He was as old California as one could be. But that is true. I do want to say, can I just add one more thing about what Steve said and also Cliff about Judge Browning? He was not political in a capital P, but he was as political as one could be with a little p. And he was all over the place explaining to people in Congress that how we needed the judges. So I truly admired him for what he did there, but he didn't proclaim it to the judges in court meetings or anything, but he was a very skillful fellow who was very close to the senators in Montana and was... it's very appropriate that our building in San Francisco is named for him.
May I say one other thing?
Definitely.
Well, first of all, you cannot in the audience imagine how we like each other. In the sense, this is the most amazing collegial court that one could ever talk about, although Judge Reinhardt once said, "If Dorothy talks about collegiality one more time, I'm leaving the room." But I go back to merit selection panels, and the plan was not to have the Bar Association pick the people who are on the commissions. In fact, I wrote my tenure piece on this whole thing about the various ways you select people from a diversified community, and some after merit selection went down the drain with some in some states. They did have the bar associations pick them all, but most of them reach out to other groups, minority groups, women's groups, and so forth, to have people on the panel. And Sam himself was a minority I had known. I was helped Tom Bradley pick his commissioners and got to know quite a few people in the community as well. I'd like to comment also on one thing about questions being asked about your family and how you can manage. And happily, I had a husband who I could not have done anything in my life without him, but when I went for my commission hearing, my younger sister had died. We had our own two children. We then had acquired her three. So I went all by myself. And when I got there, Terry Hatter, who was going to have his hearing that day, had arrived with 17 members of his family, three of whom were lawyers. He says, "Dorothy, come sit with us." And I said, "Okay." It was sort of intimidating because somebody who was controversial was also going to be questioned that day, and a lot of reporters were there. Well, I sat, and I was called for my hearing. Terry Hatter was called next. And Terry said, "You asked her what she done for minorities lately. I want to tell you, she established the Western Center on Law and Poverty." Boom, boom, boom. "Mr. Hatter, Dee Nelson has had her hearing. Will you please confine your remarks to answering our questions?" But there was something about that atmosphere that was quite different than it would have been under other circumstances. So I guess where I'm left with this is, when people ask who want to be a judge, and many of my law clerks have become judges, it's just focus on what you have a passion about. Focus on what you truly believe in. Reach out and serve the community in any way you want to, as opposed to, I'm going to go with this firm because they'll get me onto the bench, or I will go with this judge because he will get me onto the bench, or so forth. I've said enough. Sorry.
We're doing well on time. It's just a little bit after 10, and the panel is scheduled to go until 10:30. We will be definitely sure to make sure there are time for audience comments and questions. One of the first things that I was going to do was to invite the judges to do what they already have been doing, which is to jump in with any comments that they have to add based on what they have heard from the other judges on the panel here today. And it looks like Bill may be ready with something.
Yeah. I was just going to observe that one of the things that made possible this hurry up was that the president and the Senate were of the same party. Even with a really controversial person like Judge Reinhardt, this is August of an election year, presidential election year, that he was confirmed. And then many of us were during that year. In the previous few months, Bill Norris and Buchheber and I were all confirmed just within months of the election. But the other thing that I really think is true is that it would have been harder today, even with the president and the Senate in the same hands, because things have become more politicized. Yours was, but most of ours wasn't. And the amount of attention to being paid to the circuit judge level just wasn't what it is today. I couldn't have gotten confirmed a couple of decades later. I was on the state board of Right to Choose. There was one letter written to Senator DeConcini, very perfunctorily opposing me from Right to Life. Nobody appeared. There was no pressure. There's no organized opposition. I don't think that would have happened today.
Well, today, actually, I think it would have if you'd been a right winger instead of a left winger. the Senate has confirmed more people in President Trump's first year than any Democrat got confirmed within 2 or 3 years, because the right has always cared about the judiciary and understood its importance. Mm-hmm. Our constitutional law professors, Obama and Clinton, didn't seem to understand how important the judiciary is and never made the same fight for confirmation that the right wing makes.
Well,
now not only are they confirming everybody and doing it very quickly, mm-hmm. but it doesn't matter whether you have a record of saying terrible things, you get through anyway. But you were right up until this administration that if you said anything controversial, you were eliminated. They were trying to all play. We even have a Supreme Court justice who never said anything in her life that was controversial, so that she could be appointed to the Supreme Court. And anyone who really spoke out for his beliefs, right or left, was eliminated. That tradition is gone in this administration, and there are people being confirmed who are extremely controversial and being confirmed without any fight at all.
And, of course, there's plenty of time before elections. One point is implicit in your story is that if presidents do care about the nature of their appointments, they've got to get it done immediately. Both Clinton and Obama lost the Senate after 2 years.
Wasted time.
They couldn't get things through by the time they got organized. It was much, much harder. And
this year they're organized.
Huh?
This year they're organized.
That's right. Yeah, there've been probably the most organized thing the present administration has done is the appointment of judges.
I think there's another part of this too, that very often people know they came in second, and they become an irritant because if they get derailed, then they move up into the next spot. And I don't know how many were considered the second spot from you, Steve, but it isn't always the opposition that is opposing you. Sometimes it's people that are number two in the area. And to keep those people out, and this is where staff really has helped us out in this program. We knew more about what we needed to know from staff who were willing. I was getting information from people, in Steve's case, who were senior staff that wanted to see Steve on. And so it allowed us to work in a way to dull those things, just to move it forward. But, 15 judges in that short period of time with all that was going on there was really a joint effort. We had to have everything in order to do it. And Jim Browning was so adamant that we would not be satisfied with 14.
Right, but I just want to say I do think that Jimmy Carter thought that judges were important, and I wanted to disabuse Steve of the notion that there was some anonymous force that got him on the bench. I happen to believe that John Frank was the force that was very strong in that. He was very close to Shirley Hufstetler. Sam Williams was from Shirley's firm, from the Hufstetler firm, I think. And Steve had been a student of John Frank's at Yale. And John once told me somewhere during the process, I remember, that he was bound and determined that there would be one true liberal nominated to the Ninth Circuit, and that was going to be Steve. Now, I think he came to regret that from time to time over the years, but that's what he believed then.
Well, I also would say, it's been said here, but it couldn't be said strongly enough. Before the Carter appointees came, there had only been one woman on this court, one Asian, no Jews.
Right.
No blacks, no true Hispanics, no Hispanics at all, I guess, before. Shirley Hufstetler.
That wasn't political either, because Shirley was a Democrat and Senator Choi was a Republican appointee. It was just a way that things were going that needed to be shaken up to get a broader concept of what it is to have.
Absolutely. There's no doubt that was the way it was, probably all over the country.
It is
and
true.
Jimmy Carter, the most important thing he did is to diversify the bench. He wasn't interested particularly in liberal or conservative, and Griffin Bell particularly wasn't interested in having liberals if he could avoid it. But when you appoint minorities, you're likely to get people who are more liberal than those, the oppressees rather than the oppressors. But he really did change the whole face of the judiciary.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely.
That is the best thing Jimmy Carter ever did.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And one thing that I've learned when I was talking about, learned from this panel, preparing for it, when Cliff talks about the discussions that the court had, and I gave so much credit to Jim Browning for being so little political in getting all of this through, I hadn't realized that it was really, he had the full backing of the court all of this time, the court itself, those non-diverse judges on the court were behind him 100% to get this new Democratic president to fill those vacancies. I think that's quite remarkable.
One thing that comes through to me from listening to these exchanges is the collegiality expressed by the different judges. If you will forgive me, Judge Reinhardt.
Don't think I love Cliff that much.
Now, I think we have a little over 15 minutes left, and if there are people from the audience who would like to offer comments, ask questions, there is a mic here that you can come up to, and if you would just identify yourself and let us know what you're thinking, what you would like to know, what impressions you may have. And so the floor is open. And yes, I see a hand there. Will it be picked up on the sound system? Could you identify yourself?
My name is Myra Sun. I'm a criminal defense practitioner. My question is about the whole, there was some conversation before about the idea of dividing circuits or splitting up circuits, and that there was a controversy that was connected with holding this up. What was that? Was that about the 5th and 11th, or was that this circuit? Did they want to break up this circuit?
No. No, they didn't. It was the 5th and the 11th. And during, Dan Metter was in the Justice Department. You knew, Dorothy knows everybody. She is the, you know, the object lesson here is know everybody. But Dan Metter was in the Justice Department, and he was a fellow who taught at Virginia, and he had lots of squirrely ideas about judicial administration. I mean, I love the guy, but he was blind. But he had a notion that the Ninth Circuit was way too big and that it ought to be split up, or we should have specialized courts or something. And so he got a letter early on in the Carter administration signed by all 18 senators of the Ninth Circuit saying, do not break up the Ninth Circuit. And he had never seen anything like that.
And is that... what is that like now? Is there any possibility that the Ninth Circuit is going to get broken?
It would be over most of our dead bodies.
Well, it wasn't long after I came on the court that then there, Judge Hurd is absolutely correct. The split wasn't part of the expansion and of the Civity 8 Act or anything. But it wasn't very long after I came on the court that there were serious proposals, mostly from Senator Slade Gorton, who had been the a Washington State Attorney General during the salmon fishing cases, and when the Ninth Circuit, when a district judge in Seattle actually gave, you know, half the harvestable run of salmon to the Indian fishery, that's where the circuit split discussion started. It later moved also to some environmental decisions that you know that hurt the timber industry, and those have. Been very much a bone of contention for the last 20 some years. It died pretty much with President Obama's presidency, but I wouldn't predict it at all that it won't.
The idea of a circuit split is something that each chief judge deals with. I mean, it's just very time consuming and diverting from our interests. But at that time, before the Carter judges came, we as a court had already decided that we didn't want to split. The Fifth Circuit, there was a lot of reason that they believed that a split would be good for that. So they were trying to get a bill that would put together the ninth problem and the fifth problem, and then to get a judgeship bill on top of that. And so what they did was they had a compromise that the Ninth Circuit and the Fifth Circuit could decide they're going to stay together, and they could work in administrative divisions and have judges of less than the full court doing the embanks, or they could split. The Fifth Circuit held their only embank they held as a whole group, and they voted to split. We worked the other direction. Is it still up? Yes. Each time one of the senators reads a decision they don't like, they put in a bill to split the circuit. They divert our time and attention. But for reasons that we won't go into now because it's going to be discussed later in the program, they have not been successful.
Right, but it was not an issue with the appointment of the 10 judges.
I'm going to go sit down. Thank you. Yeah.
Hello, I'm Rob Feaster from Cletus, and I practice bankruptcy law, and I want to say I very much enjoyed the panel so far. I think it's outstanding. My question is whether before the addition of the Carter judges, the Ninth Circuit had a reputation as being a liberal court or not. That's a...
No. Not.
It depends on which decision you read. I mean, liberal or conservative is a political question people make, and it depends on how they want the law to go. But we had, in earlier times when I was on the court, that there were people that accused us of being liberal and others accused us of being conservative. And it has to do with they think that somehow if they could change the way or the numbers or something, that decisions would come out differently. And that was going on in the early days in the 70s when I came on the court. So it's always been there. It's just become more of a problem now.
I can answer your question somewhat differently. The judiciary is basically a stuffy conservative institution, or had been at least up until the time of the Warren Court. It basically saw its function as preserving the status quo, suppressing the labor movement, doing the bidding of the Chamber of Commerce. A little bit of that's coming back. But it had been a very traditional, stuffy institution. And the Ninth Circuit was no different from the Second Circuit or any other circuit. Mm-hmm. It was just one of the regular circuits. After the Carter judges was when we developed our reputation, which is somewhat false, I agree, as a liberal court. We're not as liberal as people say we are. There are very right-wing decisions coming out of this court, very left-wing decisions, but I should say moderate, not such left-wing decisions. But the court is, if you take one end to the other, the court, there are lots of differences, more than on courts that are smaller. Everybody goes to lunch together every day. They say, how's your wife? How's my wife? You can't tell the difference between them. But the Ninth Circuit became somewhat different when we were so expanded. And we had some real liberals and some real conservatives. You can find people on this court who are as far to the right as they think others are far to the left. So we do get very liberal and very conservative decisions. But it's totally different, I think, than it was before, when it was just a court composed of very similar people. And the one Asian we had happened to be there because he was from Hawaii, and they didn't have anything but Asians there.
But they had an Asian senator.
Yeah.
An Asian senator. But the question was what was the reputation, and the reputation was it was a conservative court like all.
What I'd like to add, since I'm the independent in this.
We count her as a Democrat, though.
What surprised me the most, becoming a judge, knowing the reputation of the court, is that we agree most of the time. It's just on a few, primarily you dealing with immigration or capital punishment, taking those out of the mix, we agree, I don't know, 85, 95% of the time, we're dealing with antitrust, employment discrimination, we're dealing with all sorts of things. And the panels are in complete agreement. We do have dissents. We have a lot of people who write concurring opinions saying, I'll go along with this opinion, but I really wish you'd said it this way. I have one that went on bonk for just that reason. But I don't know. I don't think you'll disagree that we do agree most of the time.
I'd even disagree with that. We have Social Security cases we disagree on. When you have labor management cases, there's a clear disagreement in philosophy.
One of the things that is involved in this is the perception of people who get the newspaper articles. They're the politicians. For example, we had a Pledge of Allegiance case which became very, very important to a lot of people. And the case was decided by a 2-1 case, 2-1 vote. And the then senior senator from Nevada said, see, it's those Californians again. Now we need to divide so that the rest of us who see things correctly about the flag will be together and we'll let California do its own. Well, he didn't look at and understand. To him was a political issue. But the case was written by a judge from Oregon, and the dissent was from a judge from California. He had it exactly wrong. But that made absolutely no difference at all to him, because it's politics. So a lot of what you hear about division is just a political smokescreen running along with an issue that they will think the voters will go along with. There's absolutely, you never see somebody come in and give you an analytical approach of why we should be divided. It's always a political thing.
So I don't see anything in the future that means we're going to divide in the near future.
Besides, I can't ever figure out how to do it.
Thank you.
We do have time for another question, and I see somebody coming up.
Civil and criminal litigator. Thank you very much.
And your
for
name
this
is
presentation.
I can't. Can you speak into the microphone?
Sure.
And your name is
Robert Bastian. Mm-hmm. This question is based. It's how to build on something that I see as something that's good. Is the injection of merit based? It's hard for me not to wince when I see how Judge Reinhardt just got in underneath the gate, because for every nominee like Judge Reinhardt, who faced, in particular, law enforcement opposition, there's more than one that got cut off. And it feels like that bias injects itself ultimately into strange doctrines, immunity doctrines in the courts, that ultimately affects everybody's rights, which makes it even more imperative that I wince also at resignation, that it's been a political process, it's always going to be a political process. Actually, it feels like it's getting to be more of a political process as more attention and more political capital is being put into this process. So my question is, how do you build on something? I mean, the merit concept looks like it has actually two components. One is that you want professionalization, you want competence, you want better people that can do the work. But you also, I mean, inherent in the merit concept is also protecting from some of this politicization of the process. In other words, not having people rejected, for example, Samuel Paz being rejected from the district court because he was successful in litigating against the County of Los Angeles on police abuse cases. So the question is, just seems like as long as it's going to be politicized, as long as the politicization is going to increase, the need for merit base needs to be built upon. Two questions: how do you do that? Where do you go from here? And the second question is, when you were engaged in that merit based process, was any of these political pressure groups bleeding into that process?
Well, let me just say one thing about criminal law. You know, the judiciary is flooded with prosecutors. There are no criminal defense lawyers appointed. I think that's true in state law, that's true in federal court. I don't know how you go about changing that, but the best way to get to be a judge is to be a prosecutor. The worst way to get to be a judge is to be a criminal defense lawyer.
It's true.
Shouldn't merit-based decision-making change that balance that he just mentioned?
Oh, as my friend Steve has pointed out, you run into politics wherever you go, just the Bar Association. And that could take many, many different forms. And the panel selections were quite different across the country. And in my opinion, sort of, I used to have students keep track, but they continue, were the panels still a merit selection? They continue to change, but a lot goes into not having a basic formula of calling the Federal Bar Association, send us a person, the LA County Bar, send us a person. That happens in some states where there are still panels, but it's not easy. But there are a lot of good people out there. And the question is, what are your criteria for deciding a person is a good person? And naturally, you want to have a certain basic amount of legal knowledge. But in my opinion, you know, what has this person done for the community? How does this person relate to people of all races and backgrounds, et cetera? But that's just my own opinion.
We have reached the time for the break. Thank you to our panel. And there's, I believe, coffee on the break, or as I have heard it said, this is a time in which you can choose to take on and or discharge liquids. And the break will be for 15 minutes, and we will reconvene for the second panel on the dynamics of a larger court at 10:45.